President Joe Biden announcing tonight he will end his presidential reelection campaign, an abrupt and a bit of a humbling end to a long political career. Good evening and welcome to this special live edition of Swing State. I am Bob Buckley, along with High Point University political scientist and strategic communication professor Brandon Lenore and Elon University journalism and First Amendment professor Israel Balderas. You guys have a long history, not just covering politics, but in TV, so you know how the whole thing goes both ways. Surprised at all that this announcement came at all and then came today?
Actually, not very surprised. Yeah. I mean, when the call started coming out, calling for him to step aside, it seemed like it was a matter of time. I actually predicted that it would happen on the Friday after the RNC concluded. Mm-hmm. So the surprise is actually that it came on Sunday.
What do you think?
I actually had it a day before on Twitter. If you look at my feed, I tweeted out on Thursday, today's the day. Leaks first, news of Biden overshadowing Trump's speech tonight, press conference on Friday morning. So I wasn't surprised that this was going to happen. I just think that the solemn perspective that happened over the weekend changed dramatically for President Biden.
Right after the debate, I had predicted that it would come on the Trump speech night of the convention because I thought these two kind of go back at each other in such a way that you think they're going to try to one-up each other. And I thought it might come then. But it didn't, of course. You know, either side get an advantage out of this, do you think?
Oh, absolutely. I think the perspective, the theory of the case changes now. Before, we maybe had the old man versus the con man. This is the message out on the street. Now it's the prosecutor versus the prosecuted. And I think now there's going to be more enthusiasm. We're seeing a coalescing of different groups among the Democratic Party, and certainly they have one thing in mind, that is to beat Donald Trump in November.
They finally have enthusiasm, it seems like. Yeah, what do you think, Brandon?
Well, I think that it injects a little bit of enthusiasm that was lacking. I mean, I think that what was going on, and we're going to talk about some of these things with funder, you know, the donors and age issues and everything else, I think it neutralizes some of those concerns that were originally there.
We also spoke to Michael Bitzer from Catawba College about if there's an advantage. He says there is at least one advantage for the Democratic side. Here it is.
It lets them solidify around a front runner. It lets people get re-engaged. It lets the money flow start to tick back up. Or it could be a disaster in terms of divisions, factionalism, chaos going into Chicago for the DNC.
I got to say, these guys, both too young to remember the 68 convention. I remember it in my hometown watching it when I was a young kid, and it was chaos. That can't be good for the Democratic Party.
Well, they definitely don't want to repeat that.
Right.
You know, clearly, there are echoes of 68 going on here. We have protests against the war. An unpopular war. Yeah. We have economic issues, and we have a president who has now stepped aside. So who's going to fill the vacuum? We have to wait and see. Right.
And the vice president taking over, just like in 1968.
Right.
So certainly you have those echoes. However, I think the fact that you have a more limited time between now and November changes the dynamics. At least with Lyndon B. Johnson, he dropped out of the race much earlier than Biden is doing it.
You know, I don't think we need to spend too much time on this next thing, but I want to ask quickly, was it a big deal that we didn't see President Biden say this?
100%. And I will say this, as a journalism professor, I would say that journalists need to ask some very difficult questions over the next few days. Number one, why the letter? Why not in person? Why not a press conference? Is his health worse than we are being told? That's number one. But number two, he said he's going to address the nation in a few days. My concern is that if he did get COVID and he's been battling this COVID, that it is worse than we're being told. And that raises another question. Should President Biden, if he cannot run for the White House, should he resign the White House?
Right.
Well, I'm going to take a little bit of a different tack and say, you know, he's sick. The announcement needed to come out sooner than later in order for the Democrats to be able to make adjustments. Right. And I think that if somebody's sick, it's kind of hard to expect them to go on the record.
At least do some type of White House curated photo, though,
correct,
that looks a little better. So here's the question. Is there anyone in the Democratic Party, or let me rephrase it, would it be political suicide for anyone other than Kamala Harris to step up and try to take this spot from her? Who wants to take the spot away from the first woman of color to be at the top of a ticket?
I think that's dangerous. I think that you run the risk of alienating many of the key demographics that support the Democratic Party by stepping into the breach and challenging her.
Because Democratic Party is more of an identity politics party.
Well, and you know, how much things change in just a few hours. Yeah. You and I were talking this afternoon, and we were talking about potential challengers from Gavin Newsom of California, possibly Gretchen Whitmer of Michigan. But just in the last 2 hours, we know that all 50 state Democratic chairs have come out in support of Harris. Now, we haven't heard from Pelosi. We haven't heard from former President Barack Obama. But I think in the coming days, you can expect a much more regrouping of this party.
I think you will find out when the books are written about this that the tipping point, the thing that made the president finally say, I will step down, is the money. That's when the party came to him and said, Mr. President, not only may you lose, but we'll lose the House and the Senate because we have no money.
And Politico has an article tonight talking to the two closest allies, the two closest consultants of President Biden. And they went to him yesterday, as far as Politico's reporting, and they showed him the data. And the data was, there is no road to victory, whether we're talking about the suburban votes, the women votes, the African-American votes, the Latino votes. And that data was very sort of awestruck for him.
But don't you think, Brandon, it was when they showed him you'll take down the entire party that is what turned it for him?
Well, the money is the lifeblood of the party, right. And if he can't get the money and be able to divvy it out to the various races, the Democratic Party would suffer from top to bottom.
You know, the age issue is off the table as far as being a negative for the Democrats. Is it now a negative for President Trump? You already hear the Democrats saying, well, he's a little too old to be president.
Yeah, absolutely. He's the oldest candidate now to run for president. That's going to be something that he is going to have to fight. However, on the other side, he could still say, regardless of my age, I survived an attempted assassination.
Well, I think he's seen a bump in his numbers because of that. But I think at a certain point, he has gaffes of his own, and there's going to be some more attention on that rather than it coming back on Biden.
True. He did say, though, before Biden pulled out of the race, he kept saying it's not about his age, it's about his lack of judgment. He was saying that a couple of weeks ago. That might help him a little bit there. Hey, we're just getting started here tonight. Up next, we'll talk about who might join either Vice President Harris or any other presidential nominee on the ballot, including the odds that it may be North Carolina Governor Roy Cooper. We're back with Elon University's Israel Balderas and High Point University's Brandon Lenore. We're talking presidential politics tonight after the bombshell announcement from President Biden that he is not running for re-election. You know, although it may not look like it tonight, this can really be a win-win for Biden. If his replacement wins, he can say, you know, I did the right thing, I saved the election. If that person loses, I promise you the narrative around the Biden House is going to be, well, we would have won if we stuck in. It's kind of a no-lose for him in a way, and I'm not trying to be cynical when I say that.
Well, it's true. I mean, the fact is if his replacement, if he steps aside, he's going to be lauded as making the right decision. If he loses, he can come back and say, I would have won.
Yeah.
I covered then-Senator Biden on Capitol Hill when I was a reporter, and I can tell you that history is very important for Biden. He sees what he has done through that lens, and I think tonight we are seeing a lot of folks saying he has done a brave thing, he has done a courageous thing for the country, and certainly his years of service will not go unseen and unheard.
You know, I gotta think that President Obama not endorsing Vice President Harris immediately, or at least soon, I don't think it could be a good thing, is it?
I would say this. President Obama has said he will step aside for just now to see if everyone starts coalescing around Kamala Harris. I think the idea of making Kamala Harris sort of a coronation automatic candidate is a concern for the Democratic Party. But I think in the coming days, you might see something different from President Obama.
Is it a big deal?
Well, I think it's probably a smart move. I mean, he was a very smart tactician when it came to running for office. And he's avoiding putting his finger on the needle right now. And I think he's waiting to see where things fall before he steps into the fray.
How many times has Vice President Harris called and went to his voicemail? President Obama's voicemail or Nancy Pelosi's. Who knows?
She's been on the phone call on the phone quite a bit today.
I have to think she is. You know, the biggest issues the Democratic ticket has had to deal with, though, are still on the table if Vice President Harris is the nominee.
It's true. I mean, the fact is inflation is still a concern of a lot of people, and the border is still an issue. So, you know, and those are issues that it's going to be really hard for her to distance herself from.
And especially because she was put in charge of the border. Now, Israel, you're originally from Texas. You know what it's like down there for people. This is a huge issue.
Yeah, I'm from El Paso, Texas. I know how important it is, not just for Texas, but for all border states. Mm-hmm. And because of the immigration issue, because she was in charge of this, the Biden administration gave her this as something to manage. The Republicans are already attacking her tonight. They've already, the RNC has released ads, and the number one case against her is the immigration fiasco and what's happened. On the other side of that, you've got the Republicans who want to deport 15 million Latinos, and so therefore we're already seeing this issue going up.
Is that not Vice President Harris's best argument, or the Democrats overall, is to say something like, yes, we may not have done what we should at the border, but at least we're not going to round you up like common criminals, I guess would be the term some people would use, and ship you back. Is that the Democrats' best argument?
Well, I think it's a good argument, and I think that they're also going to talk about the compromise that they tried to push through that got scuttled.
Right.
So I think that she has a little bit of wiggle room, but it's still kind of hard when you were put in charge of a big issue and the results didn't bear out.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, and let me talk about the Latino vote for just a moment, because this is an area where I research at Elon University. We've seen the Hispanic vote start moving more towards the right. We started seeing that in 2020. And certainly in states like Texas, Nevada, Arizona, we've seen more and more Latinos say, I am seriously considering voting for Republicans or for Trump. So therefore, the Democrats now have to reach out to this important voting bloc. In North Carolina, it's a 2% vote. But last time, Trump won North Carolina by 1.5%. So therefore, the Latino vote is going to be very important. And I think this is an issue that resonates with that community.
I think so. And it could be, like you both mentioned, an opportunity for Democrats. Who are the VP options? We have some boards we can look at, some of the people who are possible picks, at least at this early day, assuming, again, Vice President Harris ends up being the nominee. Roy Cooper, our governor, would be one. Got some others to run through the list here. If we can just pop through them all, we'll see them as we go through. Josh Shapiro, he is the very popular Democratic governor of Pennsylvania, done a great job. I think he'll be a terrific candidate no matter what he does down the road. Mark Kelly, the senator from Arizona, former astronaut, a wife of the husband of Gabby Giffords. And I think we have one more in this grouping, I think. Yeah, Andy Beshear, he's the Democratic governor of Kentucky. And again, a moderate and successful. I'm going to go on the record right now here live and say I think it's going to be Mark Kelly. I think Shapiro would be a phenomenal choice, but I think they want him to remain there in Pennsylvania to be their surrogate in Pennsylvania.
I think arguments can be made for each of those candidates. They bring different things to the table. When you start looking at the electoral map, and if they can even just deliver their home state, that's a win right there.
Your pick?
I'm going with Shapiro from Pennsylvania.
Okay.
I love data, and I'm looking at the map, electoral map. It's 270 to win.
Right.
That's the website that I go to. You've got five toss-up states: Pennsylvania, Michigan, Wisconsin, Arizona, and Nevada. Right.
Yep.
Those are must wins. You got Shapiro, and you've got Kelly as two possible states. Mm-hmm. However, North Carolina leans red, and it's 16 electoral votes.
Yep.
So to me, I like Roy Cooper because he makes North Carolina in play. Right? And if you can steal a state from the Republican Party, that gives you wiggle room for the other five toss-ups.
I'm going to take umbrage on that and say I don't think it does put it into play because I just don't think vice presidential candidates mean that much.
You're right, in normal state. But in this time around, I think it does for two reasons. Number one, Kamala Harris tends to be on the progressive side of the Democratic Party. So therefore, she is going to need a moderate, and a moderate that can make the case that Kamala and the Democrats can do better for America. And so therefore, I think this time around, it does make a difference.
I think it does make a difference. You and I have had this conversation a few times.
We've come to blows over it.
Yes, but I think that with Shapiro, the nice thing about what he brings to the table is kind of a lunch pail, blue collar attitude that would help with the blue wall with the Democratic Party. So not only would he help in Pennsylvania, but he could help in Michigan and possibly over in Wisconsin.
And his state is the biggest prize of all those. I would argue that the greatest value of any of these candidates, as it is with J.D. Vance, is being the surrogate out there making the case. Vance can do a lot of that stuff in Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin, because they're probably going to win Ohio anyway, the Republicans. But you're right, that could it be nullified with a guy like Shapiro? I don't know. Do we want to? I think we're good on this. I think we've got some other stuff to get to, but I think we're going to get to it in a second. How are we doing on time?
One more thing that I would say. Yeah. If you're going to talk about immigration as an important issue, Mark Kelly now really rises to the top because he is a border senator who has made this the case that the Democratic Party needs to be tougher on immigration. But the key to is his wife, Gaffney Giffords, right? She was a victim of gun violence.
Right.
And if the gun issue is an important issue for the Democrats, that's a 2-for-1 with Mark Kelly.
Good point. All right, we have more to talk about tonight, including how today's announcement affects the Trump campaign next. We're back with High Point University Professor Brandon Lenore and Elon University Professor Israel Balderas. You know, guys, former President Trump is one of those people with a very high floor, but a ceiling that's not much higher. He is going to get 43 to 45% of the vote no matter what. But I haven't seen him over 50 yet.
Right.
And a lot of that is because he plays to his base.
Yeah.
I mean, I challenge you to find somebody that if you ask them what they think of Donald Trump, that they don't have a strong opinion.
Right.
Positive or negative.
Yeah.
And I think that that's the challenge for him. That sets the floor, but it also lowers the ceiling for him.
Andrew, do you see a way I'm getting around it?
You know, you're the strategic communications expert, but I would say part of the sort of in play that the party was doing, Trump, was that they were hoping that they would have people stay home. Not necessarily get out the vote, but stay home.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think that changes the dynamic for the Trump campaign. And so now they got to figure out how are they going to rethink their case for the voters.
I want to get back to that idea because we're talking about so few people. You're not going to see the kind of landslide we saw with Ronald Reagan or George H.W. Bush again, probably, at least not in our lifetimes. We're talking about very few people. Here's Michael Bitzer talking about the way we've coalesced.
You know, folks are basically tribal loyalists in either camp. And I think here in North Carolina, we have to look at probably a 3 to 4% slice of the electorate that could swing one way or the other, that bounces down the ballot.
So that is the deal, 3 to 4%. And how do we reach that percentage?
That's the challenge.
Yeah.
I mean, and that's where the messaging comes in, and that's where discipline in your messaging plays an important role. First off, many of those people aren't paying that much attention.
Mm-hmm.
Now that the convention season's going is when they start to engage, and that's when you have the chance to maybe pull them in.
I would like each of you to make your best case for each candidate, or what you think someone will tell them their best case is. Do both Democrat and Republican. Israel, start with you.
Well, for the Democrats, my daughter Isabel, she's a huge fan of Taylor Swift. She would say, look, Taylor Swift needs to get out there and support Kamala Harris. I think tonight there's certainly that Taylor Swift idea that there's going to be a lot of people supporting, again, the first woman from a minority group, African-American woman. That's going to be a big issue. For Trump, it's going to be discipline. It's very hard for him. But if he can be disciplined and he can make the case that he can do better job than Kamala Harris, he's got a shot, but only a shot.
Well, I think for the Harris team or the to-be-named Democrat, it's going after their base. They need to be able to energize the base. And I think that the Taylor Swift idea, that might play out well. But again, with Donald Trump, it comes down to being able to tack away from just his base and tack to the middle a little bit.
I wonder, you know, the biggest argument the Democrats have had, been throwing out at least, has been the other side's a threat to democracy. Now, I am not going to say that what they did here with President Biden is the same as what was going on January 6th, because one was a constitutional issue, a legal issue, and the other, political parties are private organizations. They can do whatever they want. But when you're making the argument, We're the ones who believe in voting and following what the will of the voters is. And then you get to a point where you had a legal, fair vote, and you said, yeah, but we didn't like the way it turned out. We're going to throw it aside. Right. That sort of undercuts your credibility.
Hypocrisy? I'm shocked.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, we are now seeing that 4,000 people, 4,000 delegates to the Democratic National Convention are going to decide who will be the party's nominee. And certainly the strongest argument they had was that democracy was on the table. Tonight, Trump gets to say, look, you did not allow the person who was selected by the voters to run for office. So shame on you. Mm-hmm. You can't come after me because sort of democracy's on the table.
What do you think we're going to see? I mean, you guys have seen so many of these. You have an idea of where these things tend to go. And part of the beauty is we don't know. And it's a great ride usually. And I will say, one of the things I think everyone needs to do is take a little step back. And I don't think either side is going to ruin democracy or either side is going to destroy America. We find our way through these things. So let's have a little grace, and you can combat or you can debate the other side, but let's stop calling each other the end of civilization. That's my little diatribe. What do you think is going to play out over the next month or two? I believe Vice President Harris will solidify her hold. I think she'll be the nominee. I think she'll pick Mark Kelly, and I think we'll have a really, really close race.
I think it comes down to what happens in Chicago. Mm-hmm. If the DNC runs as smoothly as the RNC, I think the Democrats will see a bump. If it's chaos and there's protests and there's a floor fight, it could damage their ability to come out of the convention season strong.
What do you think is going to happen?
I've already said this. 2024 is an unpredictable year. Certainly the unpredictability is the health of Joseph Biden. Tonight, I am very concerned. Can he recover from this and finish out his term? If he can't, if Kamala Harris steps in and has to step in to be the president, that changes the dynamic in many, many ways.
Yeah, and here's, I think I'm glad you brought that up, because we hear some Republicans, including Mike Johnson, the Speaker of the House, say he should step down. Tom Tillis, North Carolina Senator, did. That may be what they truly believe should be done. But it ain't good politics, because the biggest challenge I think Kamala Harris has is being seen as presidential, simply not because she can't, but she hasn't been. You give her 3 months as an incumbent, she might really appear presidential to people, and you've politically hurt yourself.
Well, if she steps into the breach and does a good job, that gives her a shot in the arm for going forward in the campaign. You're throwing a Hail Mary at this point. You know, if she doesn't do a good job, then it starts to damage the down ballot process. So
they will leave her in a situation where she can't do a lot, I bet, though, and just look presidential without doing a lot. I mean,
look, we got a lot of issues internationally. Yeah. We have Palestine, Israel. We have Ukraine, Russia. Mm-hmm. We have China and Taiwan. We have a lot of international issues that are going to test either the presidential candidate or the president. And it comes down to that 3 a.m. phone call. Can Kamala Harris take that 3 a.m. phone call and say there's an international situation that you need to take care of? Mm-hmm. And would the voters be happy with her taking that phone call?
I think that is going to be the strategy the Trump team uses. They're going to bring up that phone call, and they're going to just say, who do you want to be there? Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week.